primeiro lugar, queria agradecer a presença de todos. Hoje em dia, a gente não tem tempo para nada, não dá tempo de fazer tudo que a gente tem que fazer. Então, se vocês estão dedicando tempo, terem vindo aqui à escola para ouvir o professor Charles falar sobre o currículo no século XXI, porque isso é uma prioridade para vocês, como é para nós, da EBAC, do Instituto Ayrton Senna e do Instituto Península. A EBAC é uma escola nova no Brasil, com o objetivo de oferecer ensino de qualidade mundial nas disciplinas de artes criativas, design art, audiovisual e computação gráfica. É um modelo novo de educação no país, que procura trazer muita inovação da Europa aqui para o Brasil. 7 das 10 melhores universidades hoje da Europa estão no Reino Unido. Então, a EBAC traz esses cursos para o Brasil. 80% dos cursos que nós temos aqui na escola não existem no currículo nacional. Não só a parte de conteúdo, mas a parte de metodologia de ensino é completamente diferente, inovadora, revolucionária. A escola tem 6 mil metros quadrados, recursos, estado da arte, internet, iluminação, infraestrutura e parcerias com empresas, inclusive com o Instituto Península. Então, eu gostaria de passar as palavras agora para a Elô. Muito obrigado, Instituto Península, muito obrigado, Instituto Ayrton Senna, de organizar esse evento aqui na escola. É uma honra para nós. Espero que seja de grande valia para todos o conteúdo que o professor Charles vai mostrar e que a gente consiga refletir e aplicar um pouco desses ensinamentos no nosso trabalho para evoluir a educação no nosso país, que é tão urgente, tão necessária, tão estratégico para o futuro de todos os brasileiros. Elô, por favor.
Eu vou por púlpito, porque a gente sempre precisa de uma colinha, né, gente? Então, bom dia. Meu nome é Heloísa Morel, eu sou diretora executiva do Instituto Península. Eu também estou aqui representando não só o Instituto Península, mas também o nosso parceiro Instituto Ayrton Senna, para trazer essa discussão que é tão importante para todos nós, trazer para cá o tema da gente poder discutir, não só apresentar os conceitos através de um palestrante internacional, que é o professor Charles Fadel, que traz provocações para a gente de como que a gente desenvolve o nosso currículo, mas também as competências do século XXI, e que são os temas tão relevantes para a gente no Brasil. Então, esse seminário tem esse propósito, e eu queria retribuir o nosso agradecimento para você, Maurício, e toda a sua equipe, de nos receber na sua casa. Então, muito bom para a gente também estar aqui. Queria começar com 3 recadinhos bem operacionais. O primeiro, o tradicional, por favor, desliguem os celulares, sempre ajuda, para a gente realmente poder estar aqui presente e aproveitar o dia de hoje. A segunda coisa é que vocês receberam um livro exclusivo, que é o livro do professor Fadel. Esse livro vai estar disponível para download no Facebook do Instituto Península e também no site do Ayrton Senna. Então, vocês download gratuito, portanto, vocês vão poder divulgar e dar acesso a este conteúdo para mais pessoas interessadas. E a terceira coisa é que a gente está gravando esse evento, portanto, todo o conteúdo que será discutido aqui vai estar disponível no nosso Facebook, então vocês também vão poder ver e rever o conteúdo e todas as discussões daqui para frente, tá? Então, como eu falei, a gente está com uma manhã muito especial, porque a gente vai poder abrir espaço, que é o grande objetivo do dia de hoje, abrir espaço para esse debate de duas questões cruciais para a educação brasileira, que é o currículo das escolas, o currículo escolar, e também as competências, como que a gente prepara os jovens para essas competências, para estar preparados para construir um futuro melhor para o Brasil, tá bom? Então, oficialmente, para começar o evento, eu gostaria de convidar a Maria Diniz, que é a presidente do Conselho do Instituto Península, para falar algumas palavras para vocês.
Bom dia, pessoal. É um prazer receber vocês aqui nessa casa. Eu também sou parte fundadora dessa casa e membro do conselho. Então, é um prazer tê-los todos aqui para discutir um assunto tão importante no Brasil, né? O que se ensinar para as crianças que estão hoje na escola e para as futuras gerações para viver no mundo de hoje, Porque já no mundo de hoje, o que se ensina na escola é totalmente... muita coisa não serve para nada. A gente tem aqui um dos maiores especialistas em investigação de currículo, inclusive ele trabalha, Charles Fadel, junto com a OCDE para definir como vão ser as provas, as avaliações no futuro próximo, né? Para realmente avaliar o que as crianças estão aprendendo na escola, e isso vai ajudar a direcionar os currículos no mundo também, a gente acredita nisso. Mas essa discussão é fundamental. A gente está no meio de uma discussão no Brasil muito quente, que é a discussão redesenho do ensino médio, que eu acho que a gente deveria aproveitar também essa discussão hoje para colocar nossas ideias, fazer questionamentos em relação ao redesenho do ensino médio aqui no nosso país. E acho que é uma oportunidade única para a gente trocar ideias. Eu vou falar muito pouco, só queria dar as boas-vindas para todos, agradecer a participação. Vamos participar de verdade, fazer perguntas bem desafiadoras aqui para o nosso palestrante, para o pessoal que está debatendo. E queria finalizar agradecendo muito pela primeira vez, fazendo um evento junto com o Instituto Ayrton Senna, que já estuda esse tema das competências do século XXI há mais de 5, 6 anos. E foi o primeiro instituto aqui no Brasil. A primeira vez que eu ouvi falar disso foi através do Instituto Ayrton Senna. Então, ele já tem uma longa caminhada, um grande know-how, e vão poder participar muito dessa discussão. Então, obrigada a todos e vamos ter um ótimo evento com o professor Charles Fadel. Agora, eu queria chamar a Viviane para também falar umas palavrinhas. Obrigada.
Eu queria começar agradecendo justamente a Ana pela oportunidade de a gente fazer um trabalho junto. A gente vem tentando fazer várias coisas já há um bom tempo, e a gente está fazendo um trabalho agora dentro desse campo de habilidades para o século XXI, e especialmente em relação aos aspectos socioemocionais, uma parceria ampla, sendo que essa é a primeira iniciativa concreta que a gente lança juntas, aproveitando justamente o querido professor Charles Fadel, que estava finalizando o seu livro, e aí a gente tem a honra de poder lançar isso aqui no Brasil, em conjunto. Então, é uma alegria dupla, né? Tanto poder trazer essa discussão, quanto poder fazer isso com a Ana e com o seu time, super bacana. Eles que fazem um trabalho de formação incrível, que seria maravilhoso a gente poder ter as faculdades todas de pedagogia do Brasil com esse nível, né, de sofisticação, de proposta para a formação dos professores, que nós sabemos muito bem que é um dos grandes gargalos da nossa melhoria de educação. O tema, como a Ana disse, para nós é um tema bastante central. Em 2011, a gente fez um primeiro seminário, a gente quis trazer o tema pela primeira vez num grande seminário, o Seminário Internacional de Habilidades para o Século XXI, onde a gente trouxe o professor Heckmann, que já trabalhava com socioemocionais, mas na primeira infância só, e ele era amplamente conhecido por esse trabalho, mas nós o trouxemos não para falar sobre primeira infância, mas para falar sobre toda a vida infanto-juvenil, com esse foco de desenvolvimento de habilidades socioemocionais. O professor Heckmann e mais uma série de palestrantes muito bacanas, de diferentes áreas, como genética, filosofia, enfim, diferentes pessoas para trazer a questão dessa agenda como uma agenda mega importante para a educação, entendendo que a gente precisa expandir as fronteiras da educação no sentido da qualidade, porque quantidade, como a gente estava vendo ontem, muitos que estão aqui ontem estavam no evento do lançamento do relatório do Diálogo Interamericano sobre Educação de Qualidade para a América Latina, e esse aspecto estava justamente sendo trazido, que a gente fez quantidade, mas sem qualidade na América Latina, né? Ampliamos cobertura, mas sem o acompanhamento da qualidade, e que essa é só metade da lição do século XX, não é nem falar do século XXI, é só metade da lição do século XX, a outra metade sequer a gente fez do século XX, que é ensinar as competências clássicas, como língua, matemática, que são tarefas que os países desenvolvidos já fizeram, né? E por isso estão onde estão, inclusive, mas que nós, como países latino-americanos, não fizemos ainda. E aí é tal história, nós vamos ser como aquele espadachim, que tem que lutar em duas frentes ao mesmo tempo. Vamos ter que fazer a lição de casa, que nós não fizemos ainda, de desenvolver as competências clássicas, cognitivas, que a escola, né, deveria ter desenvolvido, que todos nós conhecemos, de estabelecer, escrever, enfim, raciocínio abstrato, tudo isso. Mas também já temos as novas demandas do século XXI que já chegaram e nós vamos ficar esperando terminar a lição de casa para conseguir fazer essa. Então, nós vamos ter que fazer as duas. Né? Charles Fadel talvez não conheça tanto a situação de América Latina, mas nós não fizemos um pedaço da lição. Então, nós vamos ter que fazer os dois ao mesmo tempo. A boa notícia para nós, latino-americanos, é que esse grupo de habilidades socioemocionais, elas não só tem um valor per si extremamente relevante, que é fundamental para a gente estar preparado para o século XXI, né? Mas ela nos ajudará na tarefa de fazer a lição de casa que nós não fizemos, porque elas são extremamente críticas para a criança aprender. Elas são, na verdade, quase que alavancas para que a criança possa aprender competências cognitivas clássicas, como matemática. Ninguém aprende matemática sem ter persistência, disciplina, esforço, motivação. São todas competências socioemocionais. E eu acho que isso é que não fica claro muitas vezes. Na verdade, as competências socioemocionais são como um currículo oculto. Um currículo que está lá, subliminar para todos nós, mas a gente o recruta o tempo todo. A gente recruta esse currículo oculto na hora que você está tendo um relacionamento com um amigo, na hora que você está aprendendo matemática ou português ou qualquer coisa, na hora que você está trabalhando, na hora que você está mantendo um casamento. Eu gosto de usar esse exemplo porque ele é bem assim engraçado, na verdade. Quem é que é casado aqui? Bom, 50% praticamente. Bom, 50% que não são vão acreditar nos 50% que são. Me diga assim, será que precisa, assim, que tipo de coisa que a gente precisa para manter um casamento? A gente precisa ser mais ou menos flexível para chegar a manter um casamento? Mais ou menos? Precisa ser bastante paciente para manter um casamento? Precisa ser bastante criativo para manter um casamento? Então, assim, na verdade, a gente está recrutando essas competências o tempo todo. A gente pode até não perceber. Persistência para manter o casamento. E isso, todas as atividades que envolvem esforço, como trabalhar e estudar, estão recrutando esse tipo de habilidade. Então, o que a gente precisa? A gente precisa trazer isso para a consciência, nomear o que são essas habilidades, quais são, o que são, e desenvolvê-las deliberadamente, né? Como você faz com português, matemática e outras áreas. Então, e nós precisamos também avaliar se nós estamos ou não desenvolvendo essas habilidades, porque não adianta nada você ter a boa intenção de desenvolver, como a gente tinha na área de competências cognitivas clássicas, boa intenção de desenvolver matemática, mas se não desenvolveu, não adiantou nada, boa intenção, a mesma coisa vale para esse tipo, esse grupo de competências. Eu acho que, só para dar um exemplo, disciplina, ela pesa tanto na determinação do sucesso de aprendizagem da criança de matemática, quanto nível intelectual, nível cognitivo intelectual, QI. As duas têm o mesmo peso na determinação de aprendizagem em matemática. Você ser menino disciplinado ou você ser um menino inteligente tem o mesmo peso. Então, assim, é muito importante esse grupo de habilidades, tanto para a gente desenvolver as habilidades necessárias para as tarefas que as pessoas terão no século, já estão tendo, né, como Ana disse, no século XXI, como naquela lição de casa que países como a América Latina não fizeram, que é ensinar as competências básicas. Elas ajudam nas duas tarefas. O Instituto acredita nisso, ele vem trabalhando com essa agenda, que significa o life skills, né, a habilidade para viver, compostas tanto por competências cognitivas quanto socioemocionais, não é esquecer as cognitivas, muito pelo contrário, é ajudar a desenvolvê-las. E essa é a proposta da gente. A gente fez o seminário em 2011 e depois nós fizemos um novo seminário interministerial em 2014. Ah, não sabe o que eu. Se bobear, eu esqueço até o meu nome. Minha memória está um horror. Em 2014, é um seminário que envolvia seria o CDE, MEC e Instituto, onde a gente. O Brasil sediou pela primeira vez um evento internacional que a OCDE faz anualmente e cujo objetivo era trazer essa agenda de habilidades socioemocionais, habilidades para o século XXI, para os países, porque não é só o Brasil que precisa dessa agenda. O Charles Fadel vai falar com certeza sobre isso. Esse é uma necessidade do mundo e a OCDE está muito empenhada em trazer essa agenda para os países membros. E a primeira reunião para trazer o tema para os países membros foi justamente em 2014. A gente trouxe o evento para o Brasil, a gente já tinha parceria com a OCDE sobre esse tema e, a pedido deles, a gente desenvolveu o primeiro instrumento de avaliação socioemocional de larga escala do mundo. E nessa esteira a gente trouxe esse evento e aí vieram não sei quantos ministros, mais 14 ministros, mais especialistas. E justamente um dos grandes especialistas que foram convidados por nós para estar nesse evento foi justamente o professor Charles Fadel, que falou, esteve, né, trazendo a sua contribuição. E foi muito importante porque a gente precisa realmente gastar tempo para olhar isso. Isso não é uma competição com a agenda de desenvolvimento cognitivo de maneira nenhuma. Como eu disse, isso até ao contrário, isso vai somar e nos ajudar nessa tarefa que nós não fizemos ainda. Nós criamos em seguida um centro de inovação especialmente voltado para isso. O objetivo desse centro, que chama EduLab, ele está voltado para responder três perguntas. O que são e quais são as habilidades socioemocionais, como desenvolvê-las e como avaliá-las. A gente tem um grupo de especialistas, que o Charles Fadel conhece, um deles vocês todos conhecem, que é o PD, e estamos trabalhando justamente para ajudar a organizar o campo conceitual, porque as pessoas chamam a mesma coisa de nomes diferentes nessa área, as pessoas não sabem ainda nomear as habilidades e entendem às vezes coisas diferentes pelo mesmo nome e vice-versa. Então, e a questão de como desenvolver. O Instituto vem trabalhando no como desenvolver muito antes de 2011. Quando a gente toda aquela história dos quatro pilares da educação, eles são exatamente a versão pedagógica dessa questão de habilidades socioemocionais e cognitivas, né? Então, e a gente trabalha com isso faz praticamente 20 anos. Esse era o eixo central do Instituto. Mônica está lá fazendo assim, porque é uma das pessoas do time que esteve focada nesse trabalho durante esses praticamente 20 anos. A gente desenvolvia aprender a ser, a conviver, a conhecer e a fazer são traduções desse mesmo conceito. E a gente desenvolvia isso em todas as ações e os projetos do Instituto. Então, esse é o como fazer. Aí a gente quis trazer um pouco a organização das outras duas perguntas, que é o que a gente está fazendo também atualmente. Então, queria dar esse pano de fundo para dizer que, por isso mesmo, é super... É muito legal a gente ter a oportunidade de estar hoje aqui trazendo esse tema através do professor Charles Fadel, que vem trabalhando, vem fazendo um trabalho no mundo a respeito disso, trazendo essa agenda para diversos países no mundo e que tem uma habilidade muito grande de fazer isso. O professor Charles Fadel, vocês vão ver, é um comunicador nato e vai poder trazer um tema complexo de uma forma que todos nós possamos aproveitar muito. Parabéns, professor, e deixo a palavra a ele, que é o nosso...
Só um cumprimento aqui na introdução, junto com a Viviane, uma coisa sobre o professor Charles Fadel, que eu acho muito interessante. Ele vem, não do mundo de educação, ele vem do mundo corporativo. Ele trabalhou a vida inteira em grandes empresas de tecnologia, Então, ele vem com essa bagagem, com essa visão de mundo de quem trabalhou no mundo dos negócios. Isso acho que é muito interessante. Depois de um certo tempo, ele migrou para uma carreira de educação, de pesquisa, exatamente nessa área das socioemocionais, porque ele queria fazer a diferença no mundo, mas também porque ele achava que no mundo corporativo essas habilidades socioemocionais eram muito necessárias, né? Então, eu queria só fazer esse complemento da introdução, porque eu acho muito interessante vocês saberem disso também. Com isso, professor, é com você.
Vou fazer só uma pequena introdução. Hoje cedo eu cheguei aqui e falei, olhando o resumo, né, da biografia do professor Charles Sladel, minha pergunta para ele é se ele viveu 7 vidas nessa só. Vocês vão ver, não acaba nunca mais, a gente lê e ele continua realizando coisas, não é? E agora eu acabei de descobrir que ele ainda é executivo, então é sensacional. Professor Charles Sladel é um especialista global de ideias inovadoras para a educação, futurista e inventor. É fundador e presidente do Center of Curriculum Redesign, professor visitante da Universidade de Harvard, membro do Comitê Consultivo dos Negócios e Indústrias da OCDE, coautor da obra 21st Century Skills, fundador e presidente da Foundation Helvet Education de Genebra, conselheiro sênior da The Conference for the Human Capital Exchange e do movimento Parceria para a Aprendizagem do Século XXI. Trabalha com sistemas e instituições educacionais de mais de 30 países. E também é bacharel de Engenharia Elétrica, possui MBA e registrou 5 patentes. You need to tell me. Tell me about it.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for this introduction. It's always a delight to be in Brazil. It's my 4th time here, and I always enjoy the vibrancy of the culture and the happiness of the people. You have such a can-do attitude that the world envies you, and you have a culture that has been exported everywhere. So I hope you recognize this about yourself and feel good about your achievements as a country. It's something that really you should recognize about yourselves. So, I also want to really very sincerely thank from the bottom of my heart Ana Maria Diniz and Vivian Senna for your very enlightened leadership. I also am delighted that it's women who are carrying this leadership. I think the world needs a lot more of that rather than just the aggressiveness of some men. I'm just thinking of the United States for a second. So, with that, It's absolutely wonderful that you're doing all this. And trust me when I say very honestly that the work you're doing is actually world leading, not just Brazil leading. Seriously. I was in Finland back in September, I was in the Netherlands back in June. Everyone's struggling with these questions, you know, these are not easy questions. Everyone's trying to figure out how could we throw all these things on top of what's already there. But to do that you need to deconstruct. I was giving Ana Maria yesterday the example of the Jenga tower, you know, Jenga with the blocks that you remove and you have to have the whole tower stay up. So you have to remove carefully some blocks and put new blocks and keep the structure intact. And that's the difficulty we have to face. And we'll talk probably on the panel as well about why is it so difficult. You have dogma from experts, you have politics, you have things of that nature. And I would be terribly remiss if I didn't thank Carla Vila for her excellent project management skills. I mean, this is 21st century skills we're talking about here. And Leticia Lai for making this connection and making this happen. And of course, it all started with Juliana Porto when I met her at Harvard, and it went from there. It's been a wonderful one. I really want to thank all of them and everyone else who's been involved. And forgive me if I don't cite any single person. You're going to see me go back and forth because we have complexities to deal with from a technology standpoint. But I'm going to go back to my computer, play a couple of files, and then come back and actually be asking you questions at the same time. Sorry for the videographers. So this is actually a good demonstration that if you're ever afraid of robots taking over the world, there will be something really simple that will go wrong. Trust me, it's not going to happen anytime soon. Well, let me do this this other question. So, who do you think painted this? Do you know the artist?
Pollock.
Oh, yeah, of course. How about this? I'm going to ask you if you like this art or you don't like this art. I'm not going to give you the middle ground of you're not sure. So those of you who consider this as worse than average art, raise your hand. And those who think this is better than average art, raise your hand. That means everybody else, right? So wherever I go on the planet, I have a majority of people saying this is better than average. And the music you were going to hear, as well as the painting you saw, were composed by an algorithm, by a mathematical formula. They were not composed by humans. And you can see that it fools us because it can mimic human innovation in a way that you literally fall for it. This is to show you that we're approaching a moment here very, very important in the history of humankind where technology is able to also be innovative. So it's not just humans that are going to be innovative. Even technology can be innovative. Algorithms. Formulas we create allow us to mimic the work that I was going to have you hear from Bach or Pollock or others. So this really begs one of the questions we have here is, what do you think the world is going to be like in 20 years? And I don't mean only from the technology perspective, but all the other perspectives. You know, what are the things we have to deal with in this world to come? We're already dealing with a lot of these things, right? Climate change, financial instability, privacy, etc. And on top of all of this, we have new capabilities due to technology, but it comes in good and bad, right? It is amoral, it's non-moral, it's neither bad nor good, it just is. And it's an amplifier of humans. So if humans want to use it for good, we can do that. If you want to use it for bad, we can also do that. One thing that we have not talked about sufficiently is the population growth, right? When systems had 10 times fewer people, they were able to somewhat function. But if you're Egypt, for instance, and you went from 17 million to 80 million people in 50 years, how do you think your system is going to be able to catch up? I mean, this is the elephant in the room that very few people ever mention anymore. We've accepted its runaway, and somehow we're saying, well, but look at the bright side, it's going to plateau at 11 billion. Great, that's probably 8 to 9 billion too many. So, but that's the situation we have to face, and I wish people would accept that this is what has strained all the systems. You know, we would take it out much more easily with a significantly lower population. And, of course, we're consuming at the rate that would require three planets. We don't have that. We don't have the choice. So, that's the complexity we have to deal with. This corresponds to what futurists are describing as VUCA. Volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. And that's the world we're all facing on a daily basis. This is something, of course, that we have to pay attention to. We are at the mercy of the weakest link. It used to be that before a connected planet, we could ignore what would happen in another country. But now, suppose you ignore what happens in Western Africa with Ebola. Well, the next day it's here. And, you know, you also have to deal yourselves with another virus, and you know how that has propagated. That's how it goes. Greece has 0.5% of the world GDP and could have unraveled the financial system of the world, and still can. So we're all interconnected, and we just don't realize we're at the mercy of the weakest thing. So even if we don't want to be altruistic for good reasons, let's be altruistic for selfish reasons. There's no choice. You know, we are interdependent. This is a picture of Ebola. And we're, of course, interdependent when it comes to global warming, whether it's winter in summer or vice versa. So this is the fundamental aspect of humans. I bet you read this. right? We have hardwired in us traits that have allowed us to survive really well so far. And so it's up to us to change that, and that has to be changed through education. So the question to you now is, what do you think will be necessary for all of us and our children to be successful in a world that is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous? I'm going to ask you for your answers. What do you think?
Self-awareness.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Empathy. Thank you. I heard collaboration somewhere. Yeah, thank you.
Flexibility.
Flexibility. What else?
Dialogue.
Creativity. Yeah.
Critical thinking.
What else?
Kindness.
Ethical.
Respect.
Thank you. You see, none of you have said more trigonometry. Right? Everyone said skills and character qualities, so emotional. Surprise. So, okay. So what I'd like to do now is take a small diversion into the world of technology. I spent 25 years of my career in technology, and it has allowed me to witness the growth of these things that went from a car phone, yes, it shows how old I am, to a supercomputer in your pocket linked to immense amounts of memory and processing power in the cloud. Right, so we all have supercomputers, plural, in our pocket now. So what do we do with all this? But the point is, it has increased exponentially. And when someone grows exponentially, it's very deceiving. Because we think linearly, we see an exponential growth slow at first, and then it all of a sudden rises and it escapes our control. So whether it's global warming or Zika or whatever, these are exponential phenomena. So let's see what's happening because of exponential in technology. If this trend continues, by 2025, for $1,000, you will be able to buy computing power equivalent to 1 million brain. Now, it's computing power, not cognitive capability, but still, for $1,000, it's not bad. And if the trend continues, as you see, it's hyper-exponential, by 2060, for $1,000, all human brains. Okay, even if it's 2100, still, I think it's reasonable power, processing power. So, what this is allowing now is the start, the restart, the rebirth of artificial intelligence. And we see it applied across the board in all sorts of things, like speech recognition, automatic translation, etc., recommendation engines, and so on. It's everywhere, it's going to be even more everywhere. And it's going to be invisibly embedded in all sorts of things, and it's perfectly fine. The question, though, is what are the algorithms actually doing? What are the formulas doing? And who's behind them? And how are they filtering things for you? So that's the sort of thing we're going to have to pay a lot more attention to. And you saw, for example, Google and Facebook being called for allowing the propagation of erroneous or false news, for instance. I'm going to just do this, actually. Allow me to just reconnect to the network. I'm very happy to be here.
time. But actually, the question is, and you know, I always say this for shock, if you forgive me, but will they have a job in 10 years? Now, the reality is probably yes, because it's going to be difficult to achieve fluency of this kind. But for conversational uses, absolutely. We're going to be able to have conversational capability. We already do. One of my colleagues' mother is Chinese, does not speak English, and I use this to communicate. It's slow, it's amusing, but it works. And so for simple sentences, that's fine. But it certainly poses the question, well, should we be teaching and learning a foreign language anymore? The answer is yes, but not for the reasons we used to. Yes, communication, but not low level. Fluency, cognitive abilities, cultural aspects. Cultural aspects. If I'm speaking to someone in Russian, I better know how to not offend them, what are the cultural aspects, for linguistic purposes, for all these reasons. So it's not just the traditional way, which also means what are the fastest path to mastery of a language. Should you be using software and immersion, or do you want to teach 2 hours a year for 10 years and still not speak the language again? So do you think the technology is working now? The audio, can we try? Well, we'll try in a moment when I get to the videos. That's about it. So let's think about the robots that are embodiments of artificial intelligence in a mechanical body, right? The amazing thing about them is that they can share information. Just think about this for a second. Imagine if everyone in this room had the wisdom and the intelligence and the capabilities and the memory and the experiences of everyone else in the room, simultaneously available. And not just this room, all of Brazil. Not just Brazil, all the whole planet. Not just the planet of the present people, but the whatever, how many billions of people have existed so far. Well, we can't do that, they can. Granted, it's for narrow tasks, but it's very impressive. It means that they're going to be learning hyperbolically, not even exponentially, even faster than exponentially. Great possibilities. Imagine the intelligent agents learning from each other as well. So we're going to be quite shocked to see how fast these things eventually auto-evolve. And we're going to have to figure out, well, how do we use all of this power, all these intelligence we are creating, all these things we are creating. We are very limited by our imagination. It's really hard to imagine how we're going to do all of this. Back in 1899, Jean-Marc Cotet in France was asked to describe how he would see robots by year 2000. And for him, a robot was, well, you have a maid, of course, everybody has a maid, right? And a mechanical device, because at the time, mechanics was the high tech of the time. And so, well, this was as high tech as you could imagine it. You certainly could not imagine Roomba. It was way beyond the technology that was visible at the time. So we're going to be in the same situation in 20 years, not in 100 years. We just can't figure out. And look at this. Even the job that we feel like, well, you know, worst that can happen, I can go flip burgers at McDonald's. You know? That will be my safety job. I don't think so. Because you can have these robots that make burgers much faster, much more efficiently, and they'll never forget to ask you the important question, do you want fries? And there are plenty of other technologies coming, right? So I'm going to start showing you some of them. We don't have time. This would take an entire day worth of seminar just to show all the various technologies and their impact. But just a couple, hoping that technology works. Sometimes it's the analog part that's the hardest. After the break, because for some reason my computer crashed, the audio card crashed. And again, if you ever thought that the you were going to be taken over by machines. This is a demonstration of why something will crash. That's the good news. I will show you how you can use augmented reality, for instance, to superimpose onto existing situations a virtual image. And right now, we have to wear glasses, but the University of Washington is working on a contact lens, and you'll be able to see virtual things superimposed. So for example, we're walking together in Lugano, and we want to go to a restaurant. We can literally see, as we're walking by, the various places, the ratings of the places, and decide which one we want to stop by. More interesting, perhaps, as we walk past each other, we'll be able to see someone's profile, because it'll be instantaneous face recognition. Right. That has dangers too, exactly. And you'll be able to see someone's profile. You will even see their reputation score. You may see whether they're, you know, a criminal that's escaped. You may be even graffitied without you knowing, right? You may have someone having written something in virtual world characters above your head. You're not even they're aware that is existing there. And so we'll need a new layer of protection software, you know, to guard against reputation spamming. So, and then there's the virtual world altogether. Again, I'll show you the video in a moment after the break, but it's all about the ability to immerse yourself in a complete virtual world and have experiences that you couldn't unless you were on location. So from an education standpoint, this is huge, because now you can walk through a refugee camp, you can develop empathy by seeing, feeling what's happening without having to be there. You can walk in ancient Rome and see how it was, and on and on. So this is going to have a lot of really interesting possibilities for education. And then there's 3D printing, right? You've already experimented with that, but think that these are engine parts in titanium that have flown in aircraft already, 3D printed. And people are hard at work on prosthesis, and that implies even organs. So there's work going on with artificial livers, artificial kidneys, I mean, grown from cells that you can insert in a body and replace your liver with your own cells. Then there's a quantified self, right? How many of you have a Fitbit or equivalent when they exercise? Right, so a few people. So that Fitbit, of course, tells you your heart rate and all sorts of parameters, how well you've slept, but it can also be hacked. For me, this is the next Hollywood scenario, right? So you're running on your treadmill, and your Fitbit gives you the indication, oh, my heart rate is only 140, that's fine. Actually, it's already at 200. Because someone has hacked it and then you collapse. Next Hollywood scenario, I swear, or Black Mirror, we'll see. It's perfectly possible. So these things are hackable. And when it's connected to the Internet of Things, when your refrigerator is connected, then the Fitbit has declared, well, you've had enough calories today, I'm not opening the fridge anymore. All sorts of possibilities. And brain enhancers. Why would we be satisfied only with caffeine in the morning? Perhaps we should add a little bit of Adderall or Ritalin or, you know, some enhancement drug, because we want to function even better. So far it has not been socially acceptable. Perhaps in 10 years it will be. As you know, there are all sorts of substances that are socially acceptable in countries and not socially acceptable in others. Just think of cocaine, for instance. Nanomaterials, the ability to grow structures atom by atom from the ground up. So from everything I have presented, this is the only thing that's still truly researching. The rest is all development and soon to be available. So this is not science fiction, really. It's all now. And now there's the entire world of biotech. You know, we focused a lot on information technology, but there's also another whole world of biotech. And that's the advice I would give anyone, you know, if you're going to go into something enormously promising, biotech too, not just the information technology side. So here we are, having gone in 15 years from $1.5 billion to sequence the first genome to $1,000. It's faster than exponential. And so at $1,000, you can sequence yourself anytime. But what would you do at 10 cents? Your pet, several times a year? Your favorite bacteria? Whatever you want, you can sequence. And so this is the sort of capability that we have and will continue having, and it's going to open a whole bunch of doors. Some of them, perhaps a bit disturbing, genome editing. Well, who will resist wanting to protect the blue eyes? It seems innocuous. You know, if your dog has blue eyes, okay, that's not a problem. But will we resist having our kids be smarter? I mean, we already do all sorts of things to have our kids become smarter. We already do all sorts of things to screen against prenatal congenital diseases. So why wouldn't we feel at some point that this is our manifest destiny as humans? As the machines get smarter, we're going to say, well, we can get smarter too. Why not do that? The point is to do so with equity, and that's going to be a huge challenge. The equity part will be a challenge. And then there's stem cells, right? You can grow pieces of brain, even, using some stem cells. But you can also grow burgers. So now your burger is not using an entire cow, it's not, you know, producing methane and using a lot of water. It's just grown in a lab, and you can even put the herbs you want in layer by layer. Great tasting burger, grown in your kitchen. And perhaps that reconciles us with becoming meat eaters again. And then there's synthetic biology, where you're literally creating new bacteria from scratch. And for the first time, this has happened in 2016. There was a lab in the US that was able to create a bacteria from scratch, from piece parts, assembling piece parts, like Lego blocks. So, this is what it looks like, right? All these possibilities interfacing with each other. Impossible to figure out how all these things play. Would you have imagined that you could walk by a store and receive a coupon for the store on your cell phone? Just 10 years ago, you know, would not have imagined this. It's the confluence of so many technologies together. So, in summary, this is what's going on. We have a repeat of the Industrial Revolution on steroids. So, at the time, of course, remember how mechanical technologies created a sudden gap with education, and everyone had to go from farming into the industrial age and was very poorly prepared. And we had Charles Dickens describe the situations, the appalling situations that people had to live in. Well, eventually education systems somewhat caught up. We invented mass schooling, and we're all here. We're not working in the fields for the most part. But now we have this new challenge, the digital revolution that's happening really fast, really intensely. And the question is, will it ever slow down enough to allow us to catch up? So my concern isn't whether this is what the work we're all doing is ambitious enough. My concern is, are we going fast enough? It's not too ambitious, actually. It's perfectly appropriate. But are we going fast enough to make that change? And that's what keeps me up at night. This is because this is what happens, right? When education gets left behind, we experience social pain. When education is ahead, we experience prosperity. This is valid on a country-by-country basis and on a humanity basis. So, realizing all of this, I started this center because I felt it was really a question of making education a lot more relevant, right? I mean, making education relevant again. It was relevant for a while, it served its purpose the way it was. But as Viviane and Anne-Maria described, some of these things have run their course. And why have we lost along the way what Socrates and Confucius were telling us? You know, we've known these things forever, that an education is not just about knowledge. Somehow we truncated it back down to being just about traditional knowledge. So it's time to reopen the box a bit. In a world that requires us to be a lot more adaptable, well, you know, being a Swiss Army knife is a good analogy. I use the tool depending on the situation. The situation is always changing, it's always different. Well, then I'm well equipped. I'm versatile. That means, in essence, that we are going to be T-shaped people. You know, broad and deep, not one or the other. We have had a tendency in recent decades to become very specialized and not broad. Or we do the broad thing and we're not specialized. We have to be both. And we have to add expertise like an M over our life, develop new areas of expertise one after the other. So it's not only about studying science and technology or studying humanities or studying arts, it's an and proposition. We have to do all of that. We have to have knowledge and competencies, not one or the other. Yes, we are talking about the Renaissance people again. And we know, we all have this goal, right? It's very simple in a sense. When you see what can unify people around the world in terms of education, it's the whole Maslow pyramid. It's not complicated. Everyone around the world, irrespective of their culture, shares the same needs. And employability addresses three of these layers, but it's not the only goal of an education. It's a necessary, an important one, but not the only one. We're educating for work and for life, again, not one or the other. So for the educator to say, I'm not going to worry about your work, it's only about life, I say no, it has to be both, and vice versa. To the corporations that are intent on just training, you know, it's not just about training, it's about education. So it's all of that. So we assembled a number of very high-ranking PISA jurisdictions like Finland and Canada and Australia and a few others, working with the OECD and a number of other institutions to rethink the what question from the ground up. As you all know, we have spent so much time rethinking the how that we haven't paid attention to the what, and the requirements have changed in the meantime. We're all like this. We're all like this child saying, geez, why do I need to know this? Right? We were all in a classroom at some point thinking, tell me again why do I do this? And it's a very valid question, because if I can search for it, or if I have an intelligent agent able to retrieve it, then I perhaps should not remember it. I should remember how to find it, I should remember how to use it. It's all sorts of upskilling that's required. It's not just about fact finding, it's about understanding and using. Well, it turns out that education systems think very highly of themselves. They have this view that they're doing a great job by a factor of two. When McKinsey asked employers and youth, well, how well do you think you're doing for education? Well, employers and youth say, not so great. And education providers think, we're doing fine. So there's clearly a disconnect here. Look at some of the jobs that are emerging. I'll let you contemplate this for a second. Do you think we have enough people well trained for some of these jobs? Certainly not enough in engineering and so on. Certainly not enough social understanding. We may have enough drone operators, because there are so many kids who like playing video games, and that's perhaps good training for being a drone operator. But let's be serious. Do you think Amazon and others are going to have millions of people piloting drones to your home? No, it's going to be robotics. Right? The robot will load your package, it will be delivered with GPS to an exact address automatically, no need for an operator. Yet, when we look at how things have evolved in education going back to ancient Greece, we have been very, very slow in adapting, whether it was language or humanities or STEM. have even lost things that are important in the meantime. Why don't we teach oratory and rhetoric in school? We call it communications and it's taught only in college. Why? Why don't we teach other areas of knowledge, like robotics, like entrepreneurship? Well, part of the answer is we have no time left because the old stuff picks up all the time. And if we do, it's extra programs on the side in the afternoon or on the weekends or whatever. And why don't we pay attention to information literacy and system thinking and environmental literacy throughout? Why don't we develop skills like creativity and critical thinking? Just saying, well, I'm teaching mathematics, I'm teaching history or so on, isn't an automatic answer saying, oh, because that is being taught, therefore the students are learning skills. No. It has to be done in a much more deliberate way. Why don't we build character? Right, these are six essential qualities from which you can derive the 200 other words that people are talking about. Why don't we spend time doing this? We know it matters. All of you said it mattered at the beginning of the session. And there's a disconnect. We're not paying enough time and attention to this. And importantly, why don't we teach a growth mindset, this can-do attitude, this ability to learn and continue learning, and this ability to reflect on yourself and your learning? Look at how little people reflect on their own actions around the world. So this is the whole framework all put together. And this is, of course, the analogy I'm going to use for you. Right? We all have power plugs and we all have different sockets. However, they're all common. They're common very deeply. They're all about these four attributes. And that's the analogy I'll give you for these four dimensions of education. We all need them. It's just the local adaptation will be different. But they're all necessary for everybody. It's not like, well, this is only reserved for the few. No, it's not for everyone. The exact shape and the exact formula will slightly differ, but in essence, it's the same education. And this is how it works, and if you want, we can discuss some more about how it works. But really, as Vivian was saying earlier, it's really embedding within knowledge these components. It's not one or the other, it's one, not one on top of the other. It's just doing the two simultaneously. And so as you're teaching the competency, the knowledge, you embed all these things, but you have to do so. And this is something important, I'm going to stress this. You have to do it deliberately, systematically, demonstrably. Okay, again, deliberately. We think we are, we're not always being really good. Systematically, every single opportunity. And demonstrably, when I ask you what have you done to develop courage in your school, I want to see the exact answer. You know what I mean? You have parents who are asking you this. So these are the things we want to see across all education systems. I'm not singling you out. It's all education systems want to see this done systematically, demonstrably, visibly. Okay? And let's accept that some of these competencies will need that school as well. But you're not going to be developing courage by reading ancient Greece text about courage. Okay, we're going to have to experience this in the real world. We're going to have to do activities that build that courage, both moral and physical courage. So that's the question. Right? That's the question everyone has to ask themselves. What do we really need? So you have two layers of answer. One, in your classrooms today, you're stuck with the dogma and the tests that come, right? There's only so much you can change. Even in independent schools, you have to ascribe to a certain curriculum. So within the confines of that, you have about 25% headroom. And use that headroom to make these difficult choices. Say, you know what? We don't really need art secant. We don't need as many woodworkers and land surveyors as we did 100 years ago. So perhaps geometry is not quite as important as statistics and probabilities in a world that's full of data. So we can start rebalancing even within our classrooms. That's bottom up. Top down, what we're trying to do with my center and the OECD and others is to rethink that so we can free up time and space. And that requires a very, very disciplined re-examination of everything. Every line item. Multiplication? Yes. Division by hand? No. Polynomials by hand? No. Etc. Every subject and topic is going to have to go through this painful exercise to refocus on what matters in an age of search and artificial intelligence and employability. Here's an example from ancient Greece. I'm not picking on mathematics for you. But imagine if your class on ancient Greece was to focus on the emergence of democracy and the emergence of autocracy, Athens and Sparta, through which you realize that it took 100 years for Athens to sort out what the democratic process was. It was not Pericles who woke up one morning and said, Eureka. No, it was a painstaking, complicated approach. They muddled through, they figured out the system. It sort of worked for a number of decades, or centuries, and then it collapsed. What can we learn about the collapse? Democracies don't have the right to survive just because they're democracies. They have to be nurtured. Autocracies can do fine as well. We think that only democracies can do fine. Well, no. Plenty of autocracies do fine. They can actually move faster in some sense than democracies. And they too can collapse for a different set of reasons. So what if we understood all of that, rather than just knowing that the Agora had 432 representatives or whatever? That you can go on Wikipedia to find. What if we understood the impact of philosophers and scientists and the beginning of rationality? What if we understood how a 19-year-old was able to convince 100,000 soldiers to follow him to the edges of the known world at the time? What kind of leadership does this require? So these are the complicated questions we have to ask ourselves. What are those concepts that every discipline gives us that we carry through life, even if we have forgotten the methods and tools of the discipline? And they're the things that provide the transfer function in education across all the domains. So, I'm very, very grateful that you took the time and the energy to translate this book. I'm, forever grateful. The good news is that you're the first one of 8 languages to come out. So congratulations for being first. And there's another 7 languages coming out by the end of this year. And so this is taking the message around the world. And there's plenty of work to do, because thinking about it is 1%. The other 99% we have to all do is making it happen. That's the hard part, is making it happen. It's the other 99%. And so, I'll let you ponder this. Traditional thinking simply isn't enough. I wish it were. I wish the world was not changing as fast as it is. I really wish. We all wish. We all like stability. We're built for stability. That's not the situation. So better accept it and adapt as fast as we can. And remember, we have this as a responsibility. We have this as an opportunity. And we have it in our hands. Educators are the most important change agent in the world at this point. Greatest responsibility on our shoulders. We can do it. We have the hope to do it. And we have to carry it to the rest of the population. So thank you very much.
Question is is about one of your projections, where you compare growing education or growing technology and social pain. You say when technology is ahead of education, you have social pain. Well, technology unemploys. When technology is ahead of education, you produce unemployment or concentration of income. If you look at what happened in America a few weeks ago, people say that white people without higher education elected Trump.
Yeah.
I would say the Donald Ducks have elected Donald Trump. Well, the impoverished Donald Ducks elected. So, in a sense, we are going seeing this happens worldwide. Right-wing politicians are taking power and with xenophobic intentions. So this produces a world that's worse than before. It seems that if this tendency goes ahead, we have something like Huxley, Brave New World. People that are well-head and want to put away people that have no education and, as to say, is a weight that we don't want to carry. In the beginning of your speech, you told how to prepare children to be well in life, and this depends on which world we are, and which competences, which skills we need to produce a better world. We are now in a very unhappy situation. Let's say the tendencies are not to go ahead, but to go backwards. And this tells something about which education we need. So these skills for me are not clear.
Okay. So first of all, I'm glad that you're bringing this up. It acknowledges that education has failed. You know, we have this phenomenon happening now. Education has failed us because we have defined education as traditional knowledge rather than all sorts of other character qualities that are expressing themselves in an angry way. Education has failed because these people are not re-employable, right? They were making $50 an hour at General Motors, and now they're making $7 an hour at Walmart. Right? So they're angry, and they haven't been retrained. They haven't focused on them. And this is valid with Brexit in the US. We're going to see it in other countries. We've seen also this anger in the Philippines, etc., etc.
France
might be the next. So this is a situation of education failing to adapt, governments failing to adapt fast enough. And I'm completely with you that if you're going to be taking someone's job away, the least we could do for them is retrain them for something else. We haven't seen that happen. The thing that's even shocking to me is that I don't even see in countries really good databases showing job demand for some jobs, how you would get retrained and where, and the linkages for all of that, right? So if I'm unemployed, is there a way that says, well, I was working on cars, but there's jobs in welding. I could do this retraining to become a welder, and I need to move to Ohio. We don't have that. And that seems to be the first thing to have. Then we have to also think in terms of time horizons. Short-term, medium-term, long-term. It's a bit, now right now the patient is bleeding, right? So we need the tourniquet. The tourniquet is retraining, it's not fundamental re-education. This is gonna take 20 years plus. But we can't not do the long-term as we do the short-term, otherwise we always stay in the short-term. We have to do retraining, short-term. We have to do apprenticeships and close cooperation between corporations and the work world and the school world in the medium term, to give us the runway, the breathing space, so we can do these things for the long term. And education happens in many ways as well, meaning you can, even with the present population, you can try to start changing the message once you realize what the message needs to be. We have been tone deaf. Some parties, some governments have just not paid attention because these people didn't have a voice, and all of a sudden they have a voice. And you're seeing this even in Brazil. It's messy, of course, very messy, but hopefully it's addressing the fundamental issue here as well. So we're going to get there. It's going to be painful. You cannot isolate out a single thing and say, if we had done this, it would be so much better. Let me give you an example. We spend years and years teaching science, and you still have 60% of the population in the US believing in creationism. So it's not just about what you teach from a fact standpoint. It's a deep understanding of how things work, and that's not taught. Even when you have deep understanding, it's also personal biases. So knowing thyself. If you don't pay a lot of attention to understanding your own cognitive biases, your own emotional biases, you're never going to reflect enough on realizing that perhaps I'm wrong. Right? Perhaps, after all, you know, I am being blinded by my perspective. I need to step out of my perspective, be metacognitive, and pay attention to what's going on. So all these things can be done. Yes, we are seeing a step back. But remember, the progress of humankind has never been this straight line. It has been sputtering, painful, you know, renaissance, enlightenment, recent crash, and hopefully we'll reemerge again. I hope I answered your question.
Para a gente começar essa segunda parte do nosso evento, o professor Fadel vai passar alguns vídeos que a gente conseguiu passar na primeira parte, e aí a gente chama os panelistas para a gente vai contar, tá bom?
So we can go back to technology. What was happening is that the computer was being confused between the two objects, which is a nice little example of what will happen with an autonomous car being confused about two different possibilities to choose. So I bet you wonder about that. First of all, I'm going to play you this track. I was going to play it first. And hear how it resembles Bach. Experts around the world. Again, this is an algorithm having designed the music to sound like Bach, and this is another one. When a hologram becomes a pop star. is a hologram and look at the audience with a real band behind them. It's an anime cartoon hologram. But it shows you that even the job of pop star can be automated. Now remember, behind something like this, there are plenty of choreographers, music composers, etc., etc. But it just shows you the new world that this allows. And then this is my favorite of all. Black dancers I mentioned to you. Maybe less valuable in the future where anyone can have any art they choose on their contact lenses. Of course, we all like the atoms, not just bits, but you see what I mean. You can have the Mona Lisa if you want in your living room. So he was on a date.
Profile, so.
Well, I don't write everything on my profile.
even though it's somewhere else.
No, no, no.
So, wingman navigation is trying to help this awkward guy with no EQ understand what she's feeling, right? She's feeling anxious, impatient, unimpressed. The system is measuring her pupil dilation, her skin temperature and humidity, basically stress levels. And it's trying to help him figure out what to do by looking at her profile, trying to detect if there's something he could do to make the situation easier, like buying wine or something. So none of this is science fiction, by the way. All of these technologies already exist. It's just they haven't been rolled out to the mass market yet. And you can imagine, of course, the privacy issues, right? As I was saying earlier on, when you have an automatic system going into everything about you, and then you are in a social situation, it's going to be really interesting. What if you have only 4.5 stars? Will someone trust you if you don't have a perfect 5 star? Does anyone in the world have perfect 5 stars? If we go far enough in Europe, in anyone's life, have we all had a perfect life? Be nice. So, anyway, these are some examples. You could spend literally days going through many of these things, but this, I think, fixes the idea in your mind about everything that's possible and a lot more than that, trust me. So, all right, let's go to the panel now.